My parents divorced when I was 1 year old.
I just think she's so cute. And her eyes are full of light and life. I love that.
My father took a pilgrimage when I was 3 and became ultra Orthodox, remarried, and now I have 7 brothers and sisters. His path led him on a journey of discovering God in the desert. I couldn't understand really his journey. I didn't understand the depth of his own needs for creating a new family, for divorcing my mom, for not being there as a father.
My whole life has been shaped by this broken connection. It led me on a search for my own spiritual and emotional truths. I discovered a path very different from my father's. I came to know and work with my Native American elders who shared with me the gift of their sacred ceremonies and teachings.
This point in my life, I am preparing for this journey that is ahead, that is walking in the footsteps of my ancestors. And my ancestors are calling.
She's going to go through this soul searching to uncover her roots and what she stands for. And we come in understanding that with a reference to our family.
She is going to the desert with her father. This is medicine. This is life.
This is going to be quite a powerful walk.
What are you doing here? How did you get here? Are you lost here? Where, Sigalit? Where are we going?
This is my father when he just became Orthodox.
Yisrael grew up as a secular Jew, a Jew who didn't practice the religion, but was deeply based in the land. Whatever spiritual longings he had as a young man were fulfilled by his relationship to the desert. What attracted him is the mystical side of Judaism. He needed to pray. He needed to celebrate the festivals in a more religious way. And most of all, he needed the Sabbath and the practice of the Sabbath, which is central to any religious practice of Judaism.
Yisrael was a terrible student. All his children have learning disabilities.
I suspected that she had learning disabilities when she was quite young.
The intuitive way of learning, the feeling way of learning, the being drawn to experience rather than head knowledge, was not honored in schools as she was growing up. It's still not mostly. And I think she suffered a great deal from it.
It was extremely hard for me to sit still. It was hard for me to pretty much complete any type of homework project. All I really wanted to do was dance. If the dance teacher said, make a right, I made a left. And if she said, circle to the front of the stage, I would circle to the back of the stage. You could say that I wasn't following directions, but really what it was for me is that I was following my heart.
They called me in and they said they couldn't give her any kind of grades for the year. But that they would let her go on.
I don't feel that my mom was ever a mom. I feel like she was more of a best friend, a sister. I feel like I knew everything about her. She gave me the freedom to explore these parts of myself, and having her support in that way allowed me to really find my voice. When I went to ballet and modern classes, there was still some type of need to find that deeper source of movement, that deeper source of voice. And so I started dancing by myself. I went to the beach, I went to sacred sites in Israel, and just found myself dancing with nature. And that felt really close to my heart. That felt like I was mimicking something that was bigger and better. And I probably back then didn't know, but what I was really doing is I was communicating with just higher consciousness.
For Kabbalah, for the Jewish mystics, dance is the deepest expression of joy, because it's silence and where silence and music meet is on in the field of the body. And the body says, oh, I'm not speaking. I'm walking it. I'm singing it. I'm jumping it. I'm twirling it. It's all of those things that Parashakti, her own deep neshama, her deep soul, was pulling her towards.
Rehearsing for a dance performance in school, I had the first physical injury through dance. I did a kick in the air and I dislocated my knee. That experience began to take me into that introspective space of, who am I? Why is this happening to me? Who am I without my ability to truly express myself through movement? I felt lost just as much as I felt lost when I was sitting in class. I have these learning disabilities, and who am I in this world?
I turned 18. Like my father, I was drafted into the army.
Israel is a country that depends upon a people's army. And service is compulsory for both men and women. And Sigalit served in the entertainment corps.
Those 2 years of service were my devotion, my love. I once again received my courage and my strength and my self-esteem back. My learning disabilities really were healed through my mission. I was able to be of service both to myself and to the soldiers and to Israel. When I finished the army service, I packed my bags and moved to the States. I didn't know where I was truly going. I had a broad vision. I knew I wanted to dance, but I did feel guided. I did feel called. I did feel something bigger, something saying to me, just trust. I was a dance major at Santa Monica College and pursuing my AA degree so that I could go and study dance therapy. And then again, I had an injury, a dance injury before a performance.
I think there was a lot of pain for Sigalit in not being able to finish the program at Santa Monica College. A lot of sadness about that.
The injury was very serious. I began to think I would never dance again. That was the beginning of the dark night of the soul. I took a journey with fear, pain, trauma, and to find out what the inner child was searching for. I could no longer see who I was, where I was going, or where I belonged. I felt a deep sense of abandonment.
I found myself invited to a yoga class. My first yoga class, I found again that inner trusting voice, but this time it had a map and it had a destiny. Cultivating a relationship between body, mind, and spirit. It was going on an internal journey and being of service in a healing way for the community. That is when I decided to dedicate myself to yoga and to the path of yoga. And I lived in an ashram for 2 years, really focusing on the teachings and doing teacher training course, And that's where I received my name, Parashakti. She's the goddess of all creation. And she holds a flower in her hand. And my first name, Sigalit, is a purple violet. And my last name, Bat Haim, means daughter of life. And the Parashakti is the mother of life. When I sat with the meaning of the name, I trembled inside. That tremble was the fear inside of me of really allowing myself to go to the next level of my call of being a teacher, of being a facilitator.
The integration of Sigalit and Parashakti is the journey I have been taking ever since.
A woman at the ashram told me about Wilbert Alex and that he leads shamanic trance dances.
Trance dance was the beginnings of the use of dance as a way of transcending or connecting with one's spiritual self.
You know, the big tool that we use is a blindfold. And the blindfold separates you from your objective reality and heightens your subjective reality.
I knew I found my teacher. I knew I found the next training that I was looking for. And most of all, I knew that the voice that was guiding me was a voice that I could actually learn from, which was my own internal journey.
Sigalit has tried all her life to find a way to connect to Judaism. And the tragedy of Judaism is that most of the way it's taught is intellectual.
And so where does someone who is connected with spirit, the way that Parashakti is connected with spirit, where could she go? You know, where would she go in the Jewish tradition? It was for many centuries, women were not allowed to be leaders. Women were not allowed to be the priestess, the one who was calling and invoking prayer.
Year after year, she would say, you know, Miriam, explain to me what Hanukkah is. And I would start explaining, and I saw it go in one ear and out the other, because that's not how Sigalit learns. She doesn't learn from words, and she sure doesn't learn from books. Same thing with her dad, Yisrael.
And so here this strong spirit is stirring, and so she finds many vessels in which to pour her spirit, and then she seeks integration with her root.
I kept on exploring through the practices my own meditative dance, my own way of entering into altered states of consciousness through the practice of yoga and meditation and also dance. I would connect to what we call today spirit guides and not know what they were. I would connect to medicine helpers without knowing what medicine is. I was shape-shifting into eagles and saw what the Native American medicine of eagle is. I would connect to power animals. I would feel my body transform into certain animals and I would dance those animals. I needed guidance. The Naraya is a Native American ceremony that is led by Clyde Hall. And I was gatekept by an elder and was invited to participate. And for 11 years, that's been my home of really learning the ancient wisdom of my Native American elders.
The blindfold allows a person to see back at themselves. This is a very strong Native American teaching, to see beyond seeing. Seeing things for more than what they are, and seeing with not just the physical eyes. If you look at something with just the physical eyes, all you're going to see is the logical being of that. But if you look with your heart, you're going to see what is inside.
Through that work with my Native American elders, I developed the circle, the medicine wheel that I bring to my work today in Dance and Liberation with the opening ceremony and the invocations and the chanting. It's all part of what my elders have passed down to me.
And as we ignite this fire, I want to honor my elder Wakia Unmane, thunder he walks with.
I use this form of movement therapy in my own life, confronting my own challenges and healing them through dance.
Dance is at the core of what it means to be Jewish. The love of dance that Sigalit has is something that Sigalit has reclaimed.
I see the Dance of Liberation today like the ghost dance in the 1800s, when Indian people had a purpose to dance, to reach a spiritual realm, to discover themselves, to look at their inner being so that they could become healed themselves and then move on to healing others. The Dance of Liberation allows people to dance and to dance into another state of mind.
I set an intention to meet my soulmate and made an offering to the fire. I committed to a 40-day fast.
In traditional cultures, including the Indian culture, there's a process of going on the mountain to receive spiritual connection, spiritual insight, spiritual direction. And usually that's a fasting process without food or water, where one will go with a particular intention, and it may be simply to be the hollow vessel that spirit can move through and receive the most clear, directed inspiration and unfolding path that spirit will offer.
I feel your love dancing in the breezes over the ocean and land, washing over me like a sunset. I can feel my inner tears cleansing the path for you, dissolving the old patterns of relationship. Arms outstretched like the wings of the eagle, invoking you. My soul calls for you every moment of every hour of every day. I dance into my life, the dance of union.
2 weeks later, I was at this thing called the Omega Experience with my friend Derek, and there was Parashakti, and I said, dude, who's that?
The Omega Experience was a one-day event where I had a booth for Body Temple. And throughout the day, I was giving out flyers, and I was talking all about the mission of Body Temple, and so many people were rooting our way and saying, this is such a great thing you're doing in New York City.
Body Temple was a combination of interactive theater, shamanic rituals, club culture, and DJ hypnotic music envisioned by director Mark Sklauer. It was created as a way to honor and showcase the wild, creative spirit of New York City and its multicultural underground scenes.
Breaking my fast on the 40th day and meeting Fabian was the beginning of my dream come true, of meeting my soulmate.
It was, you know, what you read about in the great love stories, you know. Two people meet, they connect, and it's just magic onwards from that moment on.
2 weeks later, when he DJ'd for Body Temple, I already knew that I was gonna be walking down the aisle with him.
You know, it was just really miraculous just how everything just came together and how similar things just gelled.
Our wedding ceremony of a self-designed universal spiritual ritual was officiated by our dear shaman, rabbi, Muslim priestess, Swami, and of course, our New York City tribe. We had our second wedding in Jerusalem, the spiritual capital of three great religions. It is my birthright to take my vows with Fabian in the mystical land of Israel.
We
have her own infinite way of praying that really has nothing to do with religion. It has to do with the universal spirit, the universal teachings that are out there.
My seed was planted in the gardens of Islam, and from that garden I was able to grow out of that and to expand beyond what existed there. There's plenty that I've learned from there, and it's not that I'm turning away from my religion. It's the first time in the history of the planet that we have access to everything. I can go and learn from the greatest wisdom teachers of the earth, be they Buddhist, Native American, Jewish, Hindu, Muslim. It's all there.
Allah, Allah, Allah.
My father, stepmother Chaya, and my stepbrother Oria came to my wedding as an expression of their love. Because this was an intermarriage, foreign to their beliefs, they chose not to participate. They were more comfortable witnessing from a distance. I longed for my father's blessing.
We look towards the east, new beginnings, great inspiration, great love.
As the world is becoming a smaller place and as the world is becoming more and more of a tolerant place, that evolution of our existence on this earth is imminent. It's happening right now. It is the future culture of the planet.
Whether you call it Father God and or you call it Adonai or you call it Allah or it doesn't matter, or great father, or it is a sense that the universe is huge and massive and that there's an ultimate order in that universe that we connect to as beings on the land.
I cannot express in just simple words how much I love, cherish, and adore you. You are the sun in my days and the moon in my darkest nights. You are the brilliant light in my universe. You are beauty itself. You are my everything. I believe in you. I trust in you. And I have faith that you will always be there for me.
There is so much to accomplish today because a gatekeeper training usually takes a lifetime. I want to welcome you and thank you for taking part in this creation that's been a vision for 13 years. And now it's come into a place of what I call a physical dream come true. We're focusing here today on what your personal medicine is. And you're going to be dancing that medicine here.
I need the dance to the point where now I'm inspired to teach it. It's about taking knowledge that's in you and somehow bringing it to the surface and sharing it in a community and building and growing. So if I'm touching one life and then that person's touching another and we're touching it in that transformative way beyond the positive, that's when truth exists. That's when we're getting real and real healing can start to happen then.
When we decided to start thinking about bringing children into this world, we realized that we're looking in a whole different way. And I got scared.
To say it got difficult is, it did get difficult.
The idea of my children not growing up with a Jewish background, I began to feel like I was turning away from myself.
I'm not surprised that Parashakti felt that tug, you know, that sense of I'm many things, and one of the things that I am is that I am Jewish. And that is deep within me, and I can't turn my back on that. That's a very powerful assertion of the transgenerational gift that she has been bequeathed.
considering the unique dynamic that, you know, she comes from a Jewish background, I come from an Arab background, I'm a Muslim, she's a Jew, that's the foundation, but within that foundation we have evolved into all these different spaces, but there are still ancestral truths, ancestral baggage that exist within the equation.
I feel so separated from my own voice and from my own heart. What is right for me? Where do I want to go? Who do I want to be with? You know, how often do I want to go to Israel? How do the children want to grow up? All of these questions.
As time went on, the cultural differences between us grew more profound. I awoke to my love of Judaism, and Fabian embraced his Islamic identity. Neither of us wanted to raise children that were cut off from their lineage.
I decided that the best thing I could do for myself is to go to the Tree of Life.
What needs to be next? What needs to go next? What needs to end? What needs to be released? What needs to be healed? It was because of the spiritual connection that I feel with Gabriel Cousins, his way of being a spiritual father and teaching me from afar what it means to reconnect with myself and with the earth and to feel what it is to live in community and not separated, and most of all, to learn how to live with myself again.
And now to the East. This is a new time. This is a time in this moment here we've gathered for this unraveling, this releasing. So I'm calling forth great vision one, great keeper of the visions to come and be with us here.
Our deepest truths now are able to be in expression, and our heart can be open in a way that it was not open, even though we love each other so much, so deeply. This divorce is part of us really freeing each other. It's an opportunity for me to shed my old skin, to dance with my shadow, to open myself up to the impossible and the possible. Just find my authentic voice that is now feeling more than ever so free. I feel like I'm in this pivotal point right now where my soul has made a certain choice, and I don't know if I have the courage to live it, to be it, to follow my path, my soul's journey.
Parashakti had to go continue her journey. And whatever it takes sometimes. As Joe Campbell once said to me, he said, either you go to your destiny gracefully or you get dragged by your heels.
Joseph Campbell gives the image of a mirror, that you're confronting the mirror and you see a different person that you want to be, that you aspire to be, that you try to be. And you kind of need to look at that person in her or his eyes and say, no, I have to choose a different path. So she is confronting the mirror and she's allowing herself to write a new beginning.
As the prophet Yeshayahu says in the Hebrew Bible, those who trust the Creator shall renew their strength, mounting up with the wings of eagles.
Of the eagle are so magnificent. They are a symbol of freedom, expression, and deep flight of returning home. I want to recommit myself to my work. I want to find the space within myself that I can serve again, the space inside myself where I can learn and be in a community of amazing people who speak the same language as me and who can acknowledge the type of work that I do. I'm searching for the place inside of me that knows the truth.
It has been incredible to witness the evolution of Parashakti's journey and her awakening and her healing and where she has had to go in order to pick up the pieces and uncover what it is that is truly her soul's passion from her own lens, through her own being, in her own way. What is spirituality? What is her passion? What is her truth? What does she believe in?
We love each other tremendously. We really love each other a lot. Certain things in our life are happening now that we are apart, that we were dreaming of and pulling in and wishing for and praying for. And as soon as the split happened, all of a sudden these things started to happen.
I felt renewed, rejuvenated, and on my path again. For my healing to continue, I knew I would need to revisit my Eretz Moledet.
When people find a spiritual path, especially those that are in the position of healing others, we have to make a transition, and sometimes that transition takes us on a spiritual journey. And sometimes that spiritual journey leads us to where we begin.
Any forces that be around us that would interfere with the pure intention of the ceremony be instantly released. We open ourselves up to spirit and to your highest soul's purpose on this path to prepare you now for this trip back to your ancestors, to the fatherland, and to your true power as a woman. And that the energy of the magical child in you can come forth to see with new eyes that are clear and to bring forth the healing that is needed for you on this journey. Go into your heart to pour out the sadness from that little girl who lost her dad. Any of the pain, the confusion, the anger, the sadness, the resentment.
I let go of whatever barriers, obstacles, blockages that there might be in this reconnection with my father.
Yerushalayim shel Zahav, Jerusalem of gold. What joy to be here, to join the thousands of Jews who over the centuries have come to this holy site, who have placed their prayers in between the ancient stones, the only reminder of the temple that once stood here in the heart of Jerusalem. I felt a spiritual power praying at the Western Wall. I was returning back to my roots, honoring my past.
She's the greatest gift I've been given in my life, and I've been given many, many gifts. I love having her home. I wish she lived here. I want her to live here, but if that's not the fulfillment of her dream, I'd rather she fulfill her dream than fulfill my dream for her. I would much rather her name be Sigalit than Parashakti, but it's not my choice. It's her decision.
One of the things that fascinates me about Sigalit is that she's an Orthodox Jew without even knowing it. She covers her head, like Orthodox Jewish women do. She always dresses very modestly. She's highly ritualized, like Orthodox women are. Her soul is basically that of an Orthodox Jewish woman, taken on the form in the 21st century of a new age Native American earth-based seeker.
We begin the dance today by entering through the East Gate, the place of new beginnings, the place where the sun rises, the place where the eagle flies free. And for each one of you, there is a call to enter through this golden gate of new opportunity.
The fact that Sigalit has taken her inborn talent to dance and has connected it to her amazing gift of insight and intuition and profound understanding awes me.
I am honored to say that I have my mother here.
Wow. I love the fact that she is working to heal people. I love the direction that she's going in.
As a co-facilitator, I find your medicine so pure. I see that it does good to people. So intense, so real, so precise. I love this ceremony.
Mahol, which is a word in Hebrew for dance, also means michila, which means forgiveness. The dancing itself is a practice of self-forgiveness, of other forgiveness, of integration. So within the Jewish tradition, dancing is a portal into the divine. For Kabbalah, for the Jewish mystics, dance is the deepest expression of joy.
הרפואה הטובה שבאה מהאדמה. תודה לרפואה הטובה שהבית שלך בתוך הלב. אנו משחררים אותך לדרכך ומודים לך מעמקי הלב והנשמה על רפואת בית טובה.
As long as we can become hollow bones, empty vessels, so that we can fully align ourselves with who we are, what we are, our mission, our truth, then it's like a death and rebirth of the old self. So yes, of course I'm nervous, but it's more excitement because just as the sun rises every morning, so do we as human beings. We have that opportunity to give birth each and every day. So I know that I'm going to be going through some major shifts. And with those shifts, the nervousness is more like a feeling of ecstatic release, of uniting myself with my continuous purpose. And everything that doesn't serve my higher good, my walk, my mission, I ask to, you know, now that I'm back here, I ask to be able to let it go. I want to walk this journey fearless and to dance within this void that is a great mystery to me.
The realness, the genuine quality of her yearning for integration is itself the calling of our generation, which is that to bring that which has been discovered in spirituality and in the New Age back into the old place and to extract from it the nutrition, the juice, the connection with the ancestors, without being lost there, to be able to take what's there and to take what you've found and to bring them, you know, into this greater synthesis.
He was a ladies' man without understanding that that's what he was. I mean, women just loved him because he was so charismatic. I would describe the end of my marriage to Sigalit's father, Israel, as two people who loved each other, who didn't have a clue as to how to live together. Neither of us knew how to give enough to compromise, how to make it work. It's probably the most difficult thing we have to do in life, to learn how to live with somebody else who we love, but who is not doing exactly what we want him to do.
Sigalit, welcome to Israel, welcome to your family. We're very happy that you come with here. You're my sister.
Uriah is the brother I never knew I had. He is the tzaddik who holds the family together.
Good heart, good neshama. Yeah.
Way to the settlements of Bat Ayin on the outskirts of Jerusalem in what had been Palestinian territory, and today a home for Orthodox Jews.
The fact that Parashakti is going to go to the desert with her father is walking her talk, is showing that love is the most powerful and amazing power that there is. Although the two of them went through so much, everything is possible when there is the willing to really become one again. She is going to the desert with her father. This is medicine. This is life.
The minute I return to this environment, that's when I really start to ask, what are my roots? When I meet face to face with my father, who am I to be born to this? And then I return to it, so this is going to be quite a powerful walk.
Come with me to the desert. Come with me to the vastness. Come with me to the open heart, to the rising wind, to the spreading soul. When the desert gazes at the skies, it sees itself. I am drawn to the desert as it compels me to strip, like it, from all non-essentials. In the desert, in the end, I encounter myself
במערומיי.
Exposed.
כל המסע שלנו היום, המפגש הנפלא הזה במדבר שאני כבר מחכה לו הרבה הרבה שנים וגם את, כן? זה הזדמנות. וזה הדבר שאני מחכה לו, שנעשה ביחד מסע אל עצמנו. לא שאת תעשי מסע אליי ולא שאני אעשה מסע אלייך, אלא כל אחד מאיתנו אל עצמו. ואם אנחנו באמת נגיע כל אחד לנקודה הכי הכי פנימית של עצמו, בעזרת השם במסע הזה, כן? אז גם נגיע לעצמנו המשותף. כי מה שמפריד בינינו זה רק קליפות, זה לא אנחנו. כי אנחנו זה הנשמה הזכה. אנחנו ביחד, אנחנו אחד, אנחנו הגענו אל עצמנו. אני מגיע אל עצמי, את מגיע אל עצמך, וזה בעצמו כבר יעשה את זה שאנחנו נגיע אל עצמנו. אני מברך אותך ואותי, כן. מודה להשם יתברך, שנתן לנו את ההזדמנות באמת לצאת ביחד למסע אל הנקודה הפנימית שלנו.
הפסוק אומר ככה: ויעבידו מצרים את בני ישראל בפרך, וימררו את חייהם בעבודה קשה בחומר ובלבנים.
True to his Kabbalistic lineage, Abba took me underground into a narrow place so that I could experience the feeling of ancient Hebrews enslaved in Mitzrayim. This is how he helps people find the voice of their souls in the deserts.
If I'm a slave, maybe I can escape, yes? But if I am the matter itself, if I'm the building itself, if I'm a brick, how can I escape? This was the situation of us at our very beginning. And from here, yes, our way to chirut, how do you say chirut?
Freedom. Freedom.
To freedom was to get out from this situation, where to the desert.
In the Bible, it is written that the Jews in slavery, they screamed. And then when they screamed, God heard them.
Hear them already. Took him out.
And then he took them out of slavery.
Yes. Sigalit! Why are you not screaming? Go, Sigalit, go to freedom. This is your place. It's not here. It was just to remind you where you're coming from.
Everywhere that I go in the world and I facilitate ceremony, I always build a sacred space for myself. And right now we're in nature, and so I would like to offer, as we have just gone out of Mitzrayim, and that we're now going to continue to seek and continue to ask questions and continue to connect and deepen our relationship, I want to offer a prayer and to offer the blessing to this land. So any blessing that you want to say as you're holding the foundation, you're holding the rock, you're holding the message, you are my guide today, I invite you to say in Hebrew or in English.
I can take, because this is not my way, mm-hmm. to enter the air.
So I have a question for you. We have entered a very, very, very deep place to you, the desert. And you are in gratitude mm-hmm. that you can walk this land each and every time you come here. Mm-hmm. So can you say that as a prayer in your own way?
Look, this is my home mm-hmm. here.
Every single thing you do, you bless.
Yeah.
So I don't understand. This is a universal blessing right now. I don't understand why you can't do it with me. I don't understand.
No, because
what's?
No. It's okay. It's okay, Sigalit. It's okay, but it's not my way. Uh-huh. I just can't do it. I use the desert as something that helped me to do what is written here. And here. It's not written to me, such a thing to do, as a ceremony that connects me with God. That's all. But you, where you are, it's okay. It's okay. I love you. I love the things you do. Yes, I believe in you. I know that you are on your way, and you are be'emet, truthfully on your way.
I feel blessed that I have the freedom to enter into church, into temple, into any other culture that it has a mystical side to it and participate in God's work. The fact that you can't pray with me, I feel a little bit that it's not open. And I will also honor what you're saying, that you can only go by that book. And unfortunately, it saddens me that I can't sit with such a spiritual father who, feels that the desert is his home and we can't actually bless our journey together. We blessed it in the way you wanted to. We started in the way you wanted it to. I am not going to ever cover my hair completely and turn religious. So, and you are never going to sit by my side and pray with me my way. It's not going to happen. So it's good that this is coming up in our pilgrimage together. This is part of the journey. So it's okay. It's not a waste of time.
I'm not sure that this is the purpose of the journey, because this is something that needs much more work.
This is how I live my life, Abba. I wake up in the morning and I build an altar anywhere I go to sit with myself and to come to a deep grounding within myself so I can be of service to the world.
Good.
Yes.
Very
so
good.
So this is not a waste of time. And this is important, but I just want you to know
But it's not have to be a conflict with me.
It's not a conflict. I will take 2 minutes of my time and okay. I will connect myself in the way that I'm used to connecting myself. Good. And you can watch.
I thought I was going to be able to fully show who I am, and he was going to show who he is, and we were going to be able together to dance the same dance. Going into the desert with him and feeling so vulnerable, and he separated himself from me like he did when I was 3 years old, brought an absolute feeling of failure. It was extremely painful. All my life I've been running away. And here in the desert, for once, I could not run away.
When you thought that your father is Mitzrayim, you had to go away, to go to the desert, to go to the unknown, go far away, and be intimate with God, with your God. The way that God, your God meaning the way that the unknown is talking to you. And once you do that, your calling is a different calling. Okay, I want to go back. I want to go back to society, to my parents in that way, to the place that I came from. And let's see if I can make peace with that. If meeting your parent makes you immediately go to patterns of I'm the child, I'm rebelling, you don't understand me, you're different, whatever it is. Okay, back to the desert, you know, back to learning, back to study. Until you come to the place that you can see your parent in a respectful way that doesn't put you as a small child. This is the human being that my DNA came from. And I'm free to honor this human being as he or she are. Whenever you think you're enlightened, go visit your parents. I think that's a good one.
אני פשוט רוצה לגמור עם כל זה וללכת הביתה כי הוא כל כך פגע בי. כל כך פגע בי.
צריכה להבין שזה לא מתוך חס וחלילה רצון או הבנה. כאילו, זה לא רק לא רצון, זה גם לא... זה בלי הבנה לפגוע.
אבל אני אמורה ללכת אחריו, לעשות את כל מה שהוא אומר לי לעשות, ובאתי עם הלב הכי פתוח. אני לא ביקשתי ממנו לעשות שום דבר בין.
אבל זה החיים בין בני אדם שהם מאוד מאוד שונים, והם יחד עם זה מאוד אוהבים. מאוד, 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 מאוד. אז זהו.
אתמול היה קושי ביני ובין סיגלית בהליכה במדבר. אולי, כן, היא לא יכולה לחפש אחרת. כי היא נאמנה, היא אמיתית, והיא נאמנה לתחושות הפנימיות שלה. What is your name, my daughter?
My birth name is Sigalit. Mm-hmm. And my spiritual name, my name that I was given after yoga teacher training is Parashakti.
No, Sigalit. You are not Parashakti for me. No. Sigalit. Did you ever looked at it, watched it? Sigalit. Samech, Yud, Gimel, Lamed, Yud, Taf. Shining bricks, jewels of the Helling, of the holy language. Each letter, different shape, different color, different energy, different, so much, just this name, Sigalit.
I accepted an invitation to lead an evening blessing ceremony for the Zorba Festival.
Allow your cry, what brought you here to the festival, to be loud and clear. No words, just song of heart.
In my father's world, I was not Parashakti. Here, surrounded by my tribe, I received acceptance and gratitude.
Oh,
In dance, I am grounded. I find my soul, my being. It was my last day in Israel. I returned to my father's home during the great harvest festival of Sukkot, an ancient Jewish version of Thanksgiving. It is traditional to build a temporary shelter known as the Sukkah, in which we shared our meal and welcomed the presence of God.
כששואלים כמה אתם במשפחה, אז גם אם אומר שבע, אז תמיד זוכרים שיש.
I am gifting my sisters with feathers.
For me, feathers represent freedom. And it also represents the connection never to be lost, even though I'm so far away.
I was blessed to have inherited my Zadie's, my grandfather's talit. I yearned to ask my father to bless it. I didn't want to have yet another conflict. In my father's Orthodox tradition, women don't wear the talit.
Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kidshanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu להתעטף בציצית. סיגלית, בואי נתעטף יחד.
From the moment that Abba took me under the talit, it was like being embraced by the wings of the Shekhinah, of God's presence. I felt my father initiating me to be his daughter. As I was preparing to leave, Oriya spoke to my father, and they both invited me to do a blessing for the family.
Well, for me, this is a new beginning. It's not an ending. Sing out loud my song and to pray like I pray. So now that I can pray and offer in the way that I offer, I thank you for this gift.
And surrender into the darkness. Aho! Aho!
I was a little child up until my trip to Israel. Sigalit was looking for acceptance. She was looking to be held in a way that she was never held by her father, and a need for recognition and acknowledgement.
There has been a re-emergence of the feminine in relation to leadership and the feminine in relation to prayer, a return of the mystical elements of Judaism and mystical practices. So all of that is a very strong expression of the larger zeitgeist, the larger movement, which is towards unity and towards we, towards a sense of the collective consciousness.
What we call forth here is a sacred space.
When we shift our consciousness and go on our soulful journeys and live out our passionate truth, it shifts the collective consciousness incredibly, because now everybody is free. We're freeing each other to be our authentic selves instead of holding each other in the past or old way of being on unsolid foundation.
The trip to Israel created an opportunity for me to meet myself, to fully understand who I am and the roots I was born into and the gift, where before that I couldn't see the gift. In that acceptance of I am who I am and he is who he is was where the true healing happened.
Why seek out a father who was living in a remote area in another country? And yet, ironically, though it was her mom who raised her, Sigalit has a soul much more in common with her father. Both of them are intense spiritual seekers. Both of them relate more to feeling and movement than they do to the world of intellect. Both of them need expression for their soul in this world.
Try to make your story. What are you doing there? How did you get there? Are you lost there? Are there a purpose? What is your purpose? What is all this for? These millions of people suffering in the desert, dying in the desert. What are you doing here? How did you get here? Are you lost here? Where, Sigalit? Where are we going?
I would suggest that Sigalit and her father are two sides of the same person.
Now that I am walking with my inner child, there is an opportunity for growth, because I believe that without the innocence and the trust, we can't feel the liberation of being free.
Walk with me on the waking journey.
Somehow, some way, through it all I found my way. I've been high, been low, now I finally know. Inside of me, it's all I need. Inside times I find the hard times keep me down. I've been wrong, I've been right, I've nearly lost my mind. Inside of me, it's all. Upside down.